Princeton University Press Audio presents Complicit, How We Enable the Unethical and How to Stop, by Max H. Bazerman, read by Nancy Crane. This book is dedicated to the scholars most central to my understanding of ethics, Mahzarin Banaji, Dolly Chugg, Joshua Green, David Messick, deceased, Don Moore, and Anne Tenbrunsel. Preface. This is the third book that I've written on ethics. My friend and co-author, Anne Tenbrunsel, and I published the first, Blind Spots, in 2011. Blind Spots, based on collaborative research that Anne and I did between the mid-1990s and 2010, made an early contribution to the literature on the psychology of why good people often do bad things without their own awareness. Better, Not Perfect, published in 2020, moved in a more prescriptive direction, offering insights into how we can overcome barriers to behaving ethically. The book took many, many years to write, as I continually encountered relevant ideas from philosophy about which I needed to learn more. The timing of Complicit, How We Enable the Unethical and How to Stop, was very different. At the time of the 2020 U.S. presidential election, I had no idea that I might write a book on complicity. A year later, the full book was drafted and had been read by many friends and colleagues. The book was inspired by the stunning and outrageously complicit behavior of so many people that culminated in a coup attempt threatening American democracy on January 6, 2021. How could so many people willingly play a role in allowing this coup attempt to happen? As I started to learn the answers, I was struck by parallels among complicitors in so many of the most harmful events that have occurred in recent years. While I expect that most listeners will not identify with the complicitors whom I describe in chapters 2 and 3, I'm confident that listeners will identify with many of the complicitors who follow these early chapters. I include my own role in multiple episodes of wrongdoing, including an extended case in chapter 7 to highlight the ubiquity of complicity. Chapter 1. The Complexities of Complicity. In 2004, as the opioid crisis was taking off in the United States, McKinsey, the global management consulting firm, began selling advice to Purdue Pharma on how to increase sales of its opioid drug, OxyContin. McKinsey's work for Purdue continued until 2019, many years after Purdue pleaded guilty in 2007 to misbranding the drug, and opioid addiction had become a devastating national epidemic. In 2021, McKinsey agreed to a $573 million settlement with 47 U.S. states for working to help turbocharge Purdue's sales efforts. Early in their relationship, the state of California argued, McKinsey advised Purdue that it could increase OxyContin sales through physician targeting and specific messaging to prescribers. During many of the years that McKinsey was advising Purdue on how to boost sales of OxyContin and evade government regulation, the Drug Regulation Division of the U.S. Food and Drug Administration, FDA, was paying McKinsey to offer advice on how to strengthen its regulation of pharma, among other topics. McKinsey's contracts with the FDA required it to disclose such obvious conflicts of interest. But in 2021, after ProPublica asked the FDA for documents related to any such disclosures filed by McKinsey, the FDA turned up nothing after a diligent search of our files. Even after news of McKinsey's work enabling Purdue's wrongdoing became public knowledge in early 2019, the FDA continued to seek advice from McKinsey. Between February 2019 and January 2021, McKinsey received more than $20 million in new FDA contracts. McKinsey's dual role in advising the FDA and Purdue clearly worked against the public interest. In 2008, after the FDA told Purdue that it planned to require the company to submit a drug safety plan for OxyContin, Purdue tasked McKinsey with devising a response to the agency. McKinsey proposed options in a PowerPoint presentation that included suing the FDA, or banding together with other opioid producers some of which were also McKinsey clients, including Johnson & Johnson and Mallinckrodt Pharmaceuticals, to fend off new FDA regulations. When Purdue chose this latter path, McKinsey helped implement the strategy, including preparing Purdue executives for meetings with FDA officials. Around this time, the FDA paid McKinsey to develop a new operating model for the office developing drug safety plans. In 2012, the FDA issued a substantially watered-down version of the opioid safety plan, according to ProPublica. In 2013, with its FDA contracts ongoing, McKinsey recommended a number of specific sales tactics to Purdue, including focusing sales calls on high-volume opioid prescribers, pushing higher and larger, and therefore more lucrative, dosages, and trying to distribute OxyContin directly to patients and pharmacies. In 2017, McKinsey advised Purdue on how to incentivize pharmacies to write more and higher dosage OxyContin prescriptions that would actually capitalize on addiction. For example, McKinsey recommended that Purdue offer large bonuses, nearly $15,000, to pharmacies like CVS when one of their patients developed an addiction or overdosed on the opioid. McKinsey was using its immense talents to help Purdue pharma sell more pills, and it worked. North Carolina Attorney General Josh Stein, one of the leaders of the 2021 settlement with McKinsey, told The Washington Post, "The number of pills prescribed, Purdue's profits, and McKinsey's fees all skyrocketed. But so did the number of people addicted, the number of people overdosing, and the number of lives lost." Even as McKinsey worked with opioid companies to boost their sales, it continued to advise the FDA, other government groups, and nonprofits on how to abate the crisis. In 2018, when the state of Massachusetts sued Purdue over its role in the opioid crisis, McKinsey went into panic mode. Two McKinsey senior executives discussed destroying documents relating to the firm's opioid work. But as is common when McKinsey is found complicit in the wrongdoing of its clients, the firm itself did not admit to culpability in the opioid crisis. Kevin Sneeder, the global managing partner of McKinsey, issued a bland statement in response to the settlement. "We chose to resolve this matter in order to provide fast, meaningful support to communities across the United States. We deeply regret that we did not adequately acknowledge the tragic consequences of the epidemic unfolding in our communities. With this agreement, we hope to be part of the solution to the opioid crisis in the U.S." McKinsey bills itself as the trusted advisor and counselor to many of the world's most influential businesses and institutions. The firm protects itself legally by insisting that its consultants only make recommendations and leaves decisions up to the client. In other words, after paying McKinsey millions of dollars for advice, the client is free to reject that advice. Yet in recent years, McKinsey has moved into the business of helping its clients implement its suggestions. This is exactly what McKinsey did with Purdue, Colorado Attorney General Phil Weiser told the New York Times. Two McKinsey senior partners worked with members of the Sackler family, Purdue's principal owners, to put its plans in place, even overruling Purdue executives. "When you see the actions of these McKinsey partners, they were almost acting as executives of the firm," Weiser told the Times. Despite its involvement in Purdue's day-to-day decisions, McKinsey attempted to avoid taking real responsibility for its role in the opioid crisis. As we will hear in Chapter 8, Purdue is far from the only client that McKinsey has helped commit wrongdoing for profit. And while its willingness to pay $573 million in penalties may be unusual, McKinsey is not the only advisory firm that has helped clients create harm. Helping others engage in wrongdoing is not unique to famous consulting firms, of course. Many of us face decisions about whether to be complicit in others' unethical behavior, including whether to work for companies that are destroying the environment, deceiving customers, selling inferior products, or creating inequity in the world. Sometimes we assist in less damaging areas of an organization's business. Sometimes we help the wrongdoer commit harm more directly. I'm not a lawyer and I offer no legal advice in this book, but as a behavioral ethicist, I can offer guidance on whether we are complicit when others are likely to use the help we give them, whether they pay for it or not, to create harm. By describing McKinsey's role in the opioid epidemic, I do not mean to let Purdue Pharmaceuticals and the Sackler family off the hook. As we will hear in Chapter 2, there is plenty of blame to go around. And as you will hear, other complicitors helped Purdue lead so many pain sufferers to become addicted to OxyContin and overdose. The consultants, distributors, pharmacies, and prescribing physicians involved all should have considered their roles in allowing the opioid epidemic to develop. Thinking about stories you may have previously read from a different perspective, this book, Complicit, How We Enable the Unethical and How to Stop, will show that complicitors always surround the most famous evildoers. My complicity, and perhaps yours. I often face decisions about which corporations I should provide my teaching and consulting services to. Some of these calls are not hard. I would readily decline to work with Exxon, given how the company intentionally distorted the climate change debate to boost its profits. Similarly, my personal ethics would lead me to decline to work with companies in the meatpacking, tobacco, and gun industries. But I also teach in multiple open enrollment executive programs at the Harvard Business School. How should I respond when executives from organizations that I would not work with show up as my students? I believe I have an obligation to welcome them as I would any other student. After all, that is the implicit agreement I make when I agree to teach in these programs. But perhaps I am complicit by passing along effective negotiation and decision-making strategies to executives who may use them to do work that I consider to be unethical. Does the fact that I try to teach them to audit and improve their ethical behavior help my case? I will explore my own complicity throughout this book, including in an extended story in Chapter 7 that I mentioned in the preface. We have all witnessed people engaging in behaviors that we believed to be wrong. Behaviors we would never engage in ourselves. Did we speak up or take steps to stop unethical acts? When we see someone being harassed, do we speak up and protect them? When a colleague tries to give their advisee or friend an advantage in a hiring decision, do we bring their bias to the attention of the rest of the group? When our division's financials don't make sense, do we push for clarity until they do? When our organization sets the low bar of doing what is legal rather than what is right, do we argue for a higher standard? When a not-for-profit provides potentially misleading data to its donors, do we make the dishonesty clear? More broadly, when we don't stand up in the face of dishonesty, are we complicit in it? I am confident that you could add to this list of questions based on your own uncomfortable experiences with complicity. Most of the stories that I will share in Complicit focus on the business sector. Some will come from the political world and from academia. In all of these stories, too many people were complicit in the unethical behavior of others. These stories will focus on those who enabled Adam Neumann of WeWork, Elizabeth Holmes of Theranos, the Sackler family of Purdue Pharma, and many of the most notorious sexual predators of our time, including Harvey Weinstein of Miramax and the Weinstein Company. You will be familiar with some of these stories. But in contrast to past accounts of these stories, Complicit will focus on the overlooked importance of others who were complicit in the bad behavior. You will learn about the people who distributed the opioids created by the Sackler family, the venture capitalists who ignored the impossibility of WeWork's business model, Walgreens' decision to bring Theranos' fraudulent technology into its stores, and leaders who looked the other way when they should have stood up to perpetrators of sexual assault. In short, you will look at familiar stories in a new light. As we will hear, complicity can impose huge costs on all spheres of society and across eras, from the rise of Adolf Hitler in Nazi Germany, to the assault on our democracy by Donald Trump and his supporters, to the ethical, financial, and legal crises that plague too many of today's organizations, including, possibly, your own. We will also explore the psychology of why people collaborate with harmdoers, as well as how we can become less complicit. Writing Complicit has helped me think about my own past complicity with unethical behavior. I hope it will help me be less complicit in the future by prompting me to think about these issues in a more deliberative manner, and I hope that listening to the book will help you do so as well. What we know about improving ethics. Many histories of teaching ethics date back to Socrates. While Socrates authored no texts, he is known through the posthumous accounts of his students, including Plato, who went on to mentor Aristotle. The philosophical traditions established by Socrates, Plato, and Aristotle have now had an extraordinary influence on scholars' thinking about ethics for almost 2,500 years. During these 2.5 millennia, philosophers dominated the dialogue about ethics and often focused their debates on establishing what constitutes the most ethical behavior possible. One perspective from philosophy that speaks to the ethicality of complicit behavior is utilitarianism. Utilitarian philosophers argue that an action is ethical when it maximizes value for all. Some utilitarians define this as maximizing pleasure and minimizing pain for humans. Philosopher Peter Singer explicitly includes all sentient beings. According to utilitarians, when you help a company engage in behavior that allows it to make more money but imposes far greater harm on other parties, such as people who suffer from the company's pollution or customers harmed by its products, that behavior is not ethical. From a societal perspective, the harm that Purdue and McKinsey inflicted by promoting excessive opioid use far outweighed the positive value generated by reducing pain and helping these companies profit. Interest in ethics outside the philosophical community increased dramatically at the start of the 21st century with a series of high-profile corporate scandals, including the fall of energy company Enron. In the years since, there has been no shortage of news stories about very bad people who created massive harm in the world, many of whom I will discuss in this book. These early 21st century scandals put pressure on business schools to take the topic of ethics more seriously, especially since many of the leading villains had earned degrees from top business schools. Before 2000, ethics was not core to the business school curriculum. That has changed dramatically over the last two decades. And while ethics was primarily the domain of philosophers for 2,500 years, the scholars teaching and researching ethics in business schools in the new century tend to be behavioral scientists who created a new field, behavioral ethics. In a departure from the philosophical study of ethics, which focuses on how people should behave, behavioral ethics focuses on identifying how people actually behave. This marked a shift in focus from the normative study of ethics to a descriptive approach. I was a part of this evolution, and I documented my specific views and research on ethics in Blind Spots, my 2011 book with Anne Tenbrunsel. This book attempted to shine a light on the many ways in which generally good people act unethically without their own awareness. Another interesting transition concerns whom the new behavioral scientists chose to study. While much of the motivation to study and teach ethics came from stories about wrongdoers such as Kenneth Lay, Jeff Skilling, Bernie Madoff, Jeffrey Epstein, and the like, behavioral scientists soon pivoted away from these bad apples and instead focused on the surprisingly frequent bad behavior of ordinary people. Research in this area, which came to be known as bounded ethicality, reveals that many of us frequently engage in unethical behavior without conscious awareness. For example, studies on bounded ethicality found that many people discriminate based on ethnicity and gender without any awareness of their bias, and that we often fail to notice the harm that groups we belong to create. Related to the concept of bounded ethicality is the idea that humans have bounded awareness. That is, we often fail to notice and use easily accessible, perceivable, and useful information in our decision-making. I will explore the psychology of how our bounded awareness can keep us from fully noticing wrongdoing and lead us down the path of complicity. Overall, the direction taken by behavioral scientists has been very fruitful in developing insights that could help others become more ethical. One reason we focused on the unethical actions of ordinary people is that we lacked insight into how to improve the behavior of the most famous harm doers. In Complicit, I argue that we may have pivoted away from these prominent episodes of harm too quickly. While I readily admit that I know little about how to reform the worst members of society, I believe we left an important opportunity behind, one I return to in this book. We may not know how to deter the truly evil from engaging in their actions, but by stopping those around them from enabling and participating, we can halt their actions. Those who create great harm always depend on the complicity of ordinary people. This book examines how we can stop being complicit in wrongdoing, taking the needed fuel of social support away from those who want to do massive harm. Within the field of ethics, complicity is far from a new topic. In the 13th century, Thomas Aquinas listed 9 ways in which we might be complicit: by command, by counsel, by consent, by flattery, by receiving, by participation, by silence, by not preventing, and by not denouncing. Notably, Aquinas explicitly includes complicity that occurs through acts of omission, that is, by silence, by not preventing, and by not denouncing. By contrast, contemporary philosopher Christopher Cutts's complicity principle focuses on how people facilitate harm created by others by purposely participating in their wrongdoing or harm. Consistent with Aquinas's broader view, we will discuss complicity as evolving from inaction as well as from action. More important, the profiles that I develop do not emerge from an analytic structure borrowed from the philosophy literature on ethics, but rather from a descriptive account of the ways in which humans in contemporary society are complicit in the harms inflicted by others. One common criticism of philosophical writing about ethics is that it is too demanding, setting a high moral bar that is nearly impossible to reach. Too often, people reject philosophical arguments on ethics because the sacrifices required to be ethical appear too great. In the current context, it is unrealistic to expect that any of us can fully avoid complicity. I certainly do not think that I can completely avoid being complicit with creating harm for the rest of my life. But I do believe that by deliberating about my own complicity, I can dramatically reduce the degree to which I will facilitate wrongdoing in the future. I hope that this book can provide similar guidance for you. To refer back to the title and main theme of my prior book, Better, Not Perfect, I hope that complicit can make us better, even if it doesn't make us perfect. Making sense of complicity. I define complicity as being involved with others in an illegal or unethical activity or wrongdoing. My definition of complicity overlaps with the more controversial terms collaboration and enabling. Complicity implies an act that creates net harm. This is not necessarily the case for collaboration and enabling, which can be done for good. However, collaborating sometimes describes cooperation with an enemy, and enabling also sometimes describes what happens when we allow or encourage someone else, often someone we care about, to continue a destructive pattern of behavior. I will most often use the term complicity in this book, but because the negative definitions of collaborating and enabling overlap, I will use them at times. Another note is that while complicitor is not a word in most dictionaries, it is often used in legal contexts. I use the term to define those who are complicit in the harmful action of another party. Finally, both complicity and harm occur on a continuum. I will use terms related to harm throughout this book, including evil, wrongdoing, and harmful behavior. I will generally save the word evil for the most extreme cases. In the next 7 chapters, I will tell stories of harm doers who depended on 7 different but complementary profiles of complicity in their followers. These profiles form the core of the book, as they allow us to audit our own behavior and consider how we can avoid our own complicity in the future. In all likelihood, some of these profiles will appear to be about people who are very different from yourself, committing wrongs that you would never dream of committing. But I'm confident that most listeners will see at least glimpses of themselves in other profiles, particularly the latter ones. I know that I do. Each profile will narrate, in some depth, several episodes that exemplify a type of complicity. Within each profile, we will meet primary harm doers and identify and explain the complicity that surrounds them, and then delve briefly into the psychology that underlies the behavior of the complicitors. Part one of the book includes the harsher and most obvious forms of complicity, true partners and collaborators. Many listeners will not personally identify with these two profiles, yet I expect you may recognize the behavior of people you know. Most complicity in these first two categories is explicit and intentional. We will then move on in part two to five profiles of ordinary complicity, or types of complicity that many of us engage in, often without our deliberative consideration of the harm we are enabling. Psychologists Mahzarin Banaji and Tony Greenwald use the term ordinary prejudice to describe the ways in which we favor some groups of people over others outside our conscious awareness and control. I borrow their use of ordinary to describe the behavior of regular people who allow harm to develop as a result of their implicit, non-deliberative behaviors. I predict that among these profiles of complicity, most listeners will recognize themselves. These profiles cover those who benefit from privilege, those who are true believers, those who defer to authority and loyalty, those who rely on their trust of others, and those who create and accept unethical systems. These seven profiles overlap, and many stories of harm doers include complicitors from multiple profiles. These profiles also vary in the degree of responsibility that complicitors should feel for their inaction or action. I hope that this taxonomy of forms of complicity gives you ideas for reducing complicity in the future, as it has done for me. In part three, we will integrate our understanding of all the profiles and the psychology behind them to come up with solutions. In those chapters, we will address the important question of how we can become more aware of the risk of complicity and consider ways to encourage others to avoid becoming complicit when they witness or suspect wrongdoing. Part 1. Obvious complicity. Chapter 2. True partners. Between 1999 and 2019, nearly 247,000 people died of prescription opioid overdoses in the United States. Roughly the same number of people died of overdoses from illicit opioids, including heroin and fentanyl, during the same period. In 2015 alone, the nation lost more than $500 billion to the opioid crisis, measured by lost productivity and taxpayer funds spent on healthcare, law enforcement, care for children of addicts, and other costs. The opioid epidemic was driven by the pursuit of profit at the expense of the suffering of others. One organization, owned by one family, was responsible for intentionally leading millions of Americans into chemical dependency that predictably led to hundreds of thousands of deaths. Purdue Pharma, owned by the Sackler family, made billions of dollars by creating and mismarketing the pain medicine OxyContin. As we'll see, Purdue had many true partners in creating the massive harm that resulted. The history of Purdue's mismarketing of OxyContin dates to the 1950s, long before the company began selling the drug. Arthur M. Sackler was a Renaissance person, a psychiatrist, hospital administrator, patron of the arts, and advertiser. No single individual did more to shape the character of medical advertising than the multi-talented Dr. Arthur Sackler, declared the Medical Advertising Hall of Fame in 1998. His seminal contribution was bringing the full power of advertising to pharmaceutical marketing. In fact, what Sackler did was sell his marketing services to pharmaceuticals firms to lend their products a false patina of science. He taught them how to best misrepresent scientific evidence to their financial advantage, and how to radically influence doctors through so-called pharmaceutical detailing by offering bogus speakers' fees and free travel, meals, and samples. Sackler also launched journals that gave preferential treatment to biased research from his consulting clients. All these practices were designed to increase the number of prescriptions that doctors would write, rather than to guide them toward optimal medical advice. In 1952, Arthur and his two brothers, Raymond and Mortimer, who were also psychiatrists, purchased a small pharmaceutical firm, Purdue Frederick, that earned about $22,000 in annual revenue at the time. After Arthur Sackler died in 1987, his family sold off their stake in the company to Raymond and Mortimer, and its name was eventually changed to Purdue Pharma. The company began testing OxyContin as a potential pain medication in the early 1990s, and the FDA approved the drug in 1995. Arthur's descendants would later try to separate his name from the opioid scandal, given that he passed away before OxyContin existed. They also claimed to be appalled by Purdue's deceptive marketing. But Purdue applied Arthur's marketing insights to sell the drug and hired IMS, the pharmaceutical data and marketing firm he co-founded, to gain insights into doctors' prescribing habits. As Arthur had in the past, Purdue created physician education programs to provide misleading and incomplete scientific evidence about OxyContin. A couple of features of OxyContin, Purdue Pharmaceutical's brand name version of the extended-release form of oxycodone, made it susceptible to fueling the opioid epidemic. First, oxycodone is a powerful pain drug. Like morphine and heroin, its core ingredient comes from opium plants. Morphine, heroin, and oxycodone are physically and psychologically addicting narcotics. Second, the drug's extended-release feature, denoted by the CONTIN in OxyContin, made it more dangerous. The core benefit of extended-release pain medication is that chronic pain sufferers only need to take a pill twice a day. Immediate release medication requires more frequent use. With an extended release product, Purdue was able to get the FDA to allow pills to include far more active ingredients than an immediate release drug because, if used as directed, they would be released over a longer time period. However, OxyContin developed a huge following of users who had no intention of using it as directed. To disarm the time release action of the medication and achieve a quick and powerful high, abusers could crush a tablet and ingest or snort the powder, or dilute a pill in water and inject it. This type of misuse produced a euphoria akin to that of heroin, along with a similar danger of overdose. This misuse contrasts with responsible medical use, which would weigh the short-term pain relief that OxyContin provided against the product's downsides, including suppression of the respiratory system, sedation, constipation, nausea, and most important, addiction and abuse. After its launch in 1995, OxyContin jump-started the opioid epidemic, becoming the drug of choice for those most likely to abuse an opiate. While OxyContin may well have been a very useful drug for late-stage cancer patients in severe pain, for whom addiction was not a concern, it was a poor choice for many others suffering from chronic pain. When OxyContin users would try to stop using the drug, many suffered intense and painful side effects of withdrawal. Far too many became addicted and overdosed. Some people who ended up on workers' compensation due to a work-related injury never returned to work, often because they had become addicted to opioids. The challenge, as defined by Purdue in the late 1990s, was how to expand the market for OxyContin, increase patients' usage levels, and fend off concerns about abuse. It did this through a series of misleading actions. First, Purdue consistently claimed that the risk of addiction from OxyContin was extremely small. Purdue trained its sales force to claim, unsupported by any objective evidence, that the risk of addiction was less than 1%. Purdue also consistently claimed that time-release products were less attractive to addicts than immediate-release products, given that addicts wanted an immediate high rather than a gradual effect from the drug. The problem was that addicts knew how to misuse the drug to release a much larger payload up front, such that it packed a more powerful and highly addictive punch. Yet Purdue's sales force was trained to convey the false message that delayed absorption, as provided by OxyContin tablets, is believed to reduce the abuse liability of the drug. Starting in 1996, Purdue executives regularly received information that OxyContin pills were being crushed and snorted, stolen from pharmacies by desperate addicts, and being prescribed by unethical doctors who knew the pills would be abused. Yet Purdue continued to falsely market OxyContin as less prone to abuse and addiction than other prescription opioids. On multiple occasions, three top Purdue executives, President Michael Friedman, Chief Legal Counsel Howard Udell, and Chief Medical Officer Paul Goldenheim, claimed they first became aware of the increased risks of OxyContin abuse in 2000. But federal prosecutors found the words street value, crush, and snort in 117 internal notes between 1997 and 1999. In 2006, based on a multi-year investigation, federal prosecutors recommended that Purdue as a company and Friedman, Udell, and Goldenheim as individuals be indicted on felony charges, including conspiracy to defraud the U.S. government. If convicted, the executives could have gone to prison. The indictment charges a multi-object conspiracy with the overall goal of maximizing the revenues from the sale of OxyContin through fraud, deceit, and false statement, as well as lying to Congress, wrote Kurt Ogrosky, deputy chief of the fraud division at the U.S. Department of Justice, in a memo. For reasons that remain unclear, the top officials in the Department of Justice during the George W. Bush administration did not support this recommendation. Instead, they settled the case on terms much more lenient to the company and its executives. Specifically, in 2007, Purdue and the three executives pleaded guilty to a charge of misbranding OxyContin by misrepresenting its risk of addiction and potential to be abused. Purdue and the executives paid a combined $634.5 million in fines. The executives were sentenced to probation and community service. Friedman agreed to pay $19 million of the total fine. Udell paid $8 million, and Goldenheim paid $7.5 million. As Purdue's actions were being examined by regulators, legislators, and the courts, the company focused its attention on how to influence politicians. Richard Blumenthal, the Attorney General of Connecticut, Purdue's home state, highlighted his concerns about the drug company's overly aggressive marketing, both to Purdue's CEO Richard Sackler and to the media. In response, Robin Hogan, Purdue's chief spokesperson, left a voicemail message on the phone of one of Blumenthal's assistants. I want to signal our very high level of disappointment in the way the whole press was handled around the AG's comments on this Medicaid fraud. I thought we had an understanding he was going to clarify and retract the statements last night. Purdue Pharma is a significant supporter of the Democratic Party. I think there is an election coming up, and I can assure you that this has not helped his cause in this camp. In 2020, Purdue reached an $8 billion settlement with the Department of Justice and pleaded guilty to three felony counts, including conspiracy to defraud the United States and two counts of conspiracy to violate the federal anti-kickback statute. The settlement did not release the company's executives or owners from criminal liability. In 2022, after lengthy legal battles and negotiations, the Sacklers finally reached a deal with most U.S. states and the District of Columbia to help them address the damage caused by the opioid crisis. The Sacklers agreed to pay $6 billion and to release confidential documents detailing Purdue's lobbying, public relations, and marketing activities. They also attended a hearing in which people whose lives were ravaged by opioid addiction had a chance to confront them about their role in the crisis. The Sacklers negotiated immunity from current and future civil claims against them. The criminal prosecution remained a possibility. While Purdue has filed for bankruptcy, the Sacklers will remain among the wealthiest people in the world. Purdue executives Michael Friedman, Howard Udell, and Paul Goldenheim, along with many other leaders and employees of Purdue Pharmaceuticals, were undoubtedly complicit in the opioid epidemic that made many of the Sacklers enormously wealthy while killing hundreds of thousands of people and ruining many families and communities. But the complicity extends far beyond the Purdue organization and the Sackler family. For someone to get hooked on OxyContin, if they weren't stealing it or buying it from street dealers, one or more physicians would need to continually prescribe the drug to them, and a pharmacy or hospital would have to provide them with the drug. In Death in Mud Lick, his investigative account of the opioid crisis in West Virginia, Pulitzer Prize-winning journalist Eric Eyre exposes the complicity of physicians, pharmacists, and distributors in the epidemic. The term pill mill describes an office or clinic where powerful narcotics are prescribed or dispensed inappropriately or for non-medical reasons. Because federal law prohibits doctors from prescribing pain medication without a legitimate medical purpose or for purposes outside of their medical practice, many pill mills are disguised as pain management centers. Eyre tells the story of Dr. Donald Kaiser, who lost his license to practice medicine in West Virginia on charges of trading prescriptions for sex. So, Kaiser set up a pill mill in Marietta, Ohio, 170 miles away. The move to Ohio didn't slow down Kaiser's business, writes Eyre. About once a week, Kaiser sent a van to pick up patients in West Virginia and drive them free of charge to Marietta. Kaiser paid the drivers in pills, which the drivers sold on the black market. Kaiser wasn't an isolated case. For many physicians, the profits to be gained from selling prescription opioids, accompanied by little actual medical advice, was too attractive of a proposition. Save Right in Kermit, West Virginia, was one pharmacy that was complicit in the opioid crisis. Located in a coal mining region, the tiny town of Kermit was particularly hard hit by the crisis. Its citizens were prone to back injuries incurred in the mines, and poverty and despair plagued the area. Kermit's population was just 209 in 2000, according to the U.S. Census, and the town is distant from any significant population center. Yet in 2005, the small-town pharmacy Save Right dispensed an average of 54,000 opioid pills a day, all from physician-written prescriptions. People traveled many miles to wait in long lines at Save Right's takeout window for their prescription. While they waited, people illegally resold drugs in the parking lot. Many other pharmacies became well-known among OxyContin users for their lax approach to filling prescriptions. Opioids distributors, Purdue's implicit partners. Please take a moment to write down the names of firms that you think are likely among the largest 20 firms on the 2020 Fortune 500 list. If you thought of Walmart, Amazon, Exxon, and Apple, you did well, as these are the top four. You might also have thought of Ford, General Motors, and AT&T, which made the list. It is less likely that you thought of McKesson, which came in at number 8, AmerisourceBergen, which placed 10th, or Cardinal Health, listed at number 16. These are
three healthcare. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.